Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that he is Lord God, and it is who he made us. We are his, we are his people. The sheep of pasture, enter his gates with thanksgiving, in the courts with praise. Give him thanks, praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. For faithfulness continues throughout all generations. Good morning, I am Caleb Rollins. I am a life member of the SMB group, and I go to Holland Springs High School. I'm a senior, I'm an engineering program.
Good morning. My name is Jordan Athey, and I'm a member of the SMB Life Stage Leadership Team. I attend Code RVA High School. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. God, we come before you today to say thank you. Thank you for waking us up this morning. Bless our pastor, First Lady Rose, and our entire St. Paul's family everywhere. Protect all of us from everything that is not pleasing of you. Give us the students a huge hedge of protection as we go to school this week. God, protect us from all dangers seen and unseen.
Thank you.
Bless Pastor Watson as he gives us your word today. Let us listen and receive it. We thank you, God, for all of our many blessings in Jesus. Precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Come on and praise God in the sanctuary. Come on and praise God in the sanctuary. Come on and praise God in the sanctuary. Come on, anybody just thankful because of the life we live? Anybody just thankful because they woke up this morning? Anybody just thankful because they have breath in their body? Anybody thankful because they have a voice to give a great God a great praise? Is there anybody in the house thankful to have limbs that they can wave and give a great God a great praise? Now let's put all that together. Because we have breath in our body, a voice to speak, and a hand to wave, I need everybody in the room to open up your mouth, give a great God a great praise. Wave your hand with the activity of your limbs, and bless a holy God. Hallelujah. 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 Listen, this is Homecoming Sunday 2024. Stages on today, all of our life stages, and as you see all around the room, everyone is wearing their life stage colors and their life stage t-shirts. Where are my refiners? Refiners in the room, where are you? Come on, celebrate refiners. Where's prime time? Prime time. Prime time. Where is encore? Encore. Let's see who's gonna celebrate the loudest. Where is Fusion? Let me see. Aspire. Is there any Aspire in the room? Dream Chasers. Where are you, Dream Chasers? Come on, let's try that one more time. Dream Chasers. Where are you, Dream Chasers? SMB. Where's SMB in the room? imagination. Make some noise. That's what I'm talking about. That's the praise I was looking for right there. Come on, celebrate God for all of our life stages. Come on, we're going up. We're going up. We're going up in the room. Anybody ready to go up with us? The song simply says, up, up, up. Let's go higher in the Lord. Welcome our joy choir. Woo! Clap your hands.
I know you see it.
Say, God, know that I was worth it.
Even though I don't deserve it.
Yeah, I see it.
Yeah, I see it.
Oh, since homecoming, and we're celebrating all life stages. We just want to take a journey through time and music. This first half, we're going to split it in half because we got quite a bit to go through. We are going to celebrate the years and the decades of 1950s up to the 1980s. So if you were between either of those times, this message is for you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Come on, clap your hands and celebrate. In the 1950s, we welcome groups like the Caravans, singing, Lord, keep me day by day.
I want to live on
in a building
now.
get up on your feet. Sing along with us. Come on, if you know it. Get up now. Come on, sing "Oh Happy Day" along with us. Put your hands together like, come on. Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy
come on.
Day. Oh, happy day.
When Jesus was.
When
my Jesus was.
When
Jesus was. When my Jesus was.
Oh, Two times, when God gets through,
Please be patient with me.
God is not through with me.
Come on, take me out right here. When God gets through with me. Put a smile on your face, greet everybody around you, say happy homecoming. then pull out your phone and take a selfie. Take a selfie with your neighbors. Happy homecoming. Come on, take a selfie with your neighbors. Mark it homecoming 2024. It's good to see all of you in the house of the Lord. Help me celebrate the ministry of music and movement that has preceded us. And while we're celebrating today, our SMB Life Stage is leading us in worship, and one of our worship leaders was Brother Athey. Stand up, Brother Athey, and step out here. Step out here for a moment. Let them see. I want you to see how he is decorated. He is aspiring to the highest level of scouting. He will be an Eagle Scout. Come on, show him some love. He's going to be an Eagle Scout, and this Eagle Scout project is a blood drive that will take place on September the 7th, and you can find out information about it and be a participant in it by stopping at the table that they will have out on the concourse today. We want to help him over the top, even if it costs us your blood. Amen. Give him some more love, if you will. Thank you, brother. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. We are grateful to God for the opportunity to celebrate all of our young people and all of our members. Help me celebrate the new baptismal candidates today. And there's a word from the Lord that we want to share with you out of the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, verses 1 through 6. And I'd like to read it quickly out of the Message translation. We've had challenges with the internet today, so our streaming online congregation has not been able to join us yet, but they will see this later. So I want us to send them some love so they'll know we were thinking about them. Come on. Send up a shout real quick. Out of Mark chapter 6, beginning at verse 1. He left there and returned to his hometown. His disciples came along. On the Sabbath, he gave a lecture in the meeting place. He made a real hit, impressing everyone. "We had no idea he was this good," they said. "How did he get so wise, all of a sudden get such ability?" But in the next breath, they were cutting him down. "He's just a carpenter, Mary's boy. We've known him since he was a kid. We know his brothers, James, Justice, Jude, and Simon, and his sisters. Who does he think he is?" They tripped over what little they knew about him and fell sprawling, and they never got any further. Jesus told them, "A prophet has little honor in his own hometown, among his relatives, on the streets he played in as a child." And Jesus wasn't able to do much of anything there. He laid hands on a few sick people and healed them. That's all. He couldn't get over their stubbornness. He left and made a circuit of the other villages teaching. And all the people said, "Amen." Before you sit down, I need you to tell two people, lift the limits. Amen. You may be seated. Where you're from, what you've done, how you failed, and who you have been should not be a barrier to where you can go, what you can do, how you can succeed, and who you can be by the grace of God. Accept no limits. Everybody shout, no limits. Because none of us can afford to permit our past to fix our future. But in order to live out our legacy, we're going to have to lift our limits. In fact, what you brought with you today will determine what you will take with you when you leave. Listen, if you please. There was a Russian diplomat who was invited by his American counterpart to go to a stadium to watch a professional football game. The Russian had never seen a football game before. And after the game was over, the American asked the Russian what he thought about the game. He said, "I've never seen such first-rate enthusiasm for such a second-rate game."
The Russian didn't know anything about football, and therefore the knowledge that he brought with him to the stadium limited what he received at the game in the stadium. Okay, let me try it again. I heard a story about a man that toured the Louvre in Paris and was privileged to see the Mona Lisa. After gazing intently for several minutes, the man informed his tour guide that he didn't see anything special about this piece of art, to which the tour guide said, "Sir, the painting is not on trial, you are." He didn't know anything about art, and therefore the knowledge he brought with him to the museum limited what he saw in the museum. I'm told that you can take a goldfish from his bowl, fill a bathtub with water, and put him in it, and he will still swim in a small circle because his past has fixed his future. I hope you're getting this, because in order to live out your legacy, you're going to have to lift your limits. And that's the truth tagged in the text we have targeted to teach today. For here, Jesus arrives in his hometown. Look at your neighbor, say, it was homecoming. And one translation says his disciples came along. On the Sabbath, he gave a lecture in the meeting place. He made a real hit, impressing everyone. We had no idea he was this good, they said. How did he get so wise all of a sudden, get such ability? But in the next breath, they were cutting him down. He's just a carpenter, Mary's boy. We've known him since he was a kid. We know his brothers, James, Justice, Jude, and Simon, and his sisters. Who does he think he is? They tripped over what little they knew about him and fell sprawling, and they never got any further. The people of Nazareth discounted, devalued, and disbelieved Jesus, and their doubt limited his demonstration in their domicile. Please don't miss this, that their deficit of faith diminished his deeds and blocked their blessings. He did not do many mighty works there because of their disbelief. It wasn't that he could not, he did not, because of the mire of their mistrust. He had the power. Jesus walked on water. Jesus exorcised demons. Jesus healed the sick. Jesus raised the dead. Jesus gave sight to the blind. He had the power. He walked into a room shrouded by death, and when death met divinity, a little girl was restored to life. He had the power, and yet when he came to his hometown, he did not do many mighty works there because of their disbelief. That is amazing. How could it be possible for humans to limit the power of the Lord? But in Psalm 78, the songwriter pointed out that Israel limited the manifestation of God's power in their midst because they did not believe. And the self-same tragedy happened in Nazareth. Doubt inhibits the activity of divinity. Did you hear what I said? That God can do it, but we must believe it. Help me teach. Tell somebody, say, you gotta believe. You can limit how God works in your life. You can limit what God does in your life. You can limit what is possible for your life. You can restrict the aspirations, accomplishments, achievements, and acquisitions that God wants to deposit in the account of your life if you fail to believe. Don't take my word for it. Matthew 9:29, Jesus said, according to your faith, it shall it be unto you. Tell somebody, say, it's your faith. Don't miss it. You get to choose the limits on your life, the limits on your promise, the limits on your blessing. It's not according to your family, your finances, your fame, your fortune, your friends, or your failures, but according to your faith, because God has critic-crushing, agenda-wrecking, expectation-defying dreams for your life, but they won't manifest without your faith. It's unfathomable to imagine all the great things that God could do and would do if we allow God to work like God wants to work in us and through us. This text today is a cheerless commentary. Listen again, he made a real hit, impressing everybody. We had no idea he was this good. How did he get so wise all of a sudden, get such ability? But in the next breath, somebody shout, next breath. They were cutting him down. He's just a carpenter, Mary's boy. The people in Jesus' hometown had low expectations of him and for him. They were afflicted by what I want to call today the fatal familiar. That's where people put you where they think you belong and then believe you're still there because that's where they left you the last time around. Look at your neighbor and say, I ain't there no more, eh? They try to keep you where they had you. They limited him first because of his vocation. He was a carpenter for years. He had apprenticed at the bench of his stepdaddy Joseph. He followed in his stepdaddy's footsteps and earned his union card as a carpenter. He built things. And while this description primarily speaks to his humanity, it also directs us to his divinity, because while in time he built the tangible in eternity, he built the intangible. This carpenter constructed the cosmos. He built the universe and stamped it with his logo. Dr. S.M. Lockridge said he didn't have to put his signature on the sunrise, nor his mark on the meadows, nor carve his name on the mountains, and yet they are all his, made by his hands. This carpenter constructed the cosmos and even now is actively constructing citizens to replicate and reflect his glory and his image. Ephesians 2:10 attests that we are God's masterpiece. Your neighbor didn't hear that, but look at him and say, you sitting next to a masterpiece. Amen. No, you got to tell him with attitude if you're going to say something like that. Say, you ain't never sat next to nothing like this. You are sitting next to a masterpiece. That's what the Bible says. And we are still under construction. Christ is busy building us up right now. How, preacher? He's strengthening you through your struggles. He's shaping you in your stress. He's directing you in your difficulties. He's training you in your troubles. And he's not finished with you yet. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah right there. It's Philippians 1:6 that says, he that has begun this good work in you is able to complete it, and he will. Christ is constructing the cosmos, its citizens, the church, and our conclusion one day in the celestial city. In John 14:2, Jesus told his disciples, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you unto myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. But not only is Christ in the business of construction, he is also in the business of renovation. He can fix a broken life. He can fix a broken marriage. He can fix a broken heart. He can repair the damage of your past. He can restore the losses you've incurred. He can reassemble the pieces of your shattered experience. Can anybody co-sign that affidavit? He came as a carpenter and they despised him. Is not this the carpenter? Haven't we known him all our life? Is not this the man who made tables and chairs and plows? Is not this the man who mended broken things when we brought them to him? They said in another translation, we watched this boy grow up. We knew his daddy, Joseph. He's just a carpenter. He's not anything special. They limited him because of his vocation, but also because of his location. He's a carpenter from Nazareth. Can I encourage you right here? Never permit anybody to predict or prognosticate about your future, because they don't know what your future holds. People will never understand your breakthrough if they can't comprehend your been through. Did you hear what I just said? You may not be seen, known, recognized, celebrated, or sought right now, but nobody can say what's going to happen in your future. Let me try and help you. The boss of a big company needed to call one of his employees about an urgent problem with one of their main computer servers. He dialed the employee's number only to be greeted by a child who whispered, "Hello," feeling put out at the inconvenience of having to talk to a child. The boss asked, "Is your daddy home?" The small voice said, "Yes." The boss said, "May I talk with him, please?" To his surprise, the little boy said, "No." Wanting to talk with an adult, the boss asked, "Is your mama home?" "Yes," came the answer. "May I talk with her?" And again, the small voice whispered, "No." Knowing that the child was probably not home alone, he asked, "Well, is there any adult there besides you?" He said, "Yes, there's a policeman here." Wondering what was going on, the boss said, "May I speak with the policeman?" The little boy said, "No, he's busy." The boss said, "Busy doing what?" The little boy said, "Talking to my mama, my daddy, and the fireman." And growing worried as he heard a helicopter through the phone, the boss asked, "What's that noise?" The little boy said, "That's the hello chopper." Nervous, the boss said, "What's going on?" The little boy said, "The search team just landed in the hello chopper." Alarmed and even more than a little frustrated, the boss said, "Well, why are they here?" Still whispering, but now giggling, the little boy said, "They looking for me." You gotta grab that. Because people may not think you are much now, but one day, somebody's gonna be looking for you. Somebody's gonna be wishing they knew you. Somebody's gonna be sorry they didn't appreciate you. They limited him because of his vocation and his location. He was from a common working class family, wore work clothes, and worked a common job. And his neighbors, friends, and colleagues saw this not as an advantage, but as an annoyance. They didn't value him for his vision. They devalued him for his dream. They didn't affirm his ability. They denied his deity. They limited the Lord. And that's why I tell people all the time, if nobody else believes in you, you have to develop the discipline to believe in yourself. There may be nobody on your bench and no cheerleaders on your team, but with God on your side, you can still win in the game of life. This is a living lesson for our learning, because everybody listening to me has a limit somewhere in your life that you have accepted for yourself or that others have imposed upon you that needs to be lifted, and now is the time to do it. And let me help you here, because we limit the power of God working in us and working for us, first of all, when we permit our faith to be encumbered by emotions. If you don't mind, look at somebody and say, "It ain't about how you feel." Okay, that's the wrong person. Look at another person and say, "Get out of your feelings." In Mark chapter 6, verse 3, the text says, they were offended at him. Stay with me. They heard that Jesus was coming to town and what he had done in other places. Yet they surmised, "We know this man. He grew up in our midst. He played with our children. He's the carpenter's son, and he is a carpenter. He's just Jesus, Mary's boy." Notice they called him son of Mary, Mary's boy, because rumors were already rampant in that ancient community. He's Mary's boy, but we don't know who his daddy is. Why should we believe in him? Their faith was encumbered by emotions. They felt, ebonically speaking, some kind of way about Jesus. You cannot permit your feelings to supersede your faith. Faith is bigger than your feelings. There will be days when you don't feel saved, when you don't feel delivered, but that doesn't change the fact that you are saved and you are delivered by the grace of God. There may be moments when you feel like you're not going to make it, but that doesn't change the fact that if God be for you, who can be against you? The text says, But in the next breath, they were cutting him down. He's just a carpenter, Mary's boy. We've known him since he was a kid. We know his brothers. We know his sisters. Who does he think he is? Now, in the older translations of this text, it says not that they were offended, but they became angry. His words and works were too significant to ignore and too accredited to deny. So it made them angry. Some of the people who are angry with you are just angry because of what God has done for you. Anger is often a place of refuge for people who don't know what to do with your strength. Did you hear what I just said? And the truth is, they're not so much angry with you as it is they are afraid of you. That's what causes people to resist rejoicing when God allows you to rise. But as you deepen your relationship with God, you come to realize that you don't have to be angry at anybody. You ain't got to be jealous of anybody, who they are, what they've done, what they have, what they've achieved, because what God has for you, it is for you. I need you to affirm that with both your neighbors and look at them and say, you can't get what's mine. Amen. Wait, God wants to empower you to break the curse of the ordinary over your own life so that you can go on and become the person that God created you to be. Don't worry about them. It's time to focus on Him. You are destined to be a trendsetter, a pacemaker, a rule breaker, a headlight in a world full of taillights. Because get this, when it's your time and your turn, nothing can stop you. It may be your time, but not your turn. It may be your turn, but not your time. But when your turn and your time come together, things will take place. It's not about how you feel. It's about focusing on what's real. A mature faith believes God no matter how it feels. So don't let your faith be encumbered by emotions. But secondly, we limit the power of God working in us and for us when we permit our faith to be abbreviated by appearances. They said, we know who this man is. Listen to how arrogant that is. They had him frozen in a snapshot from the past. Preach, preacher, we know who he is. You don't know who nobody is. You don't even know who fully who you are and what you'll do under every circumstance. Just look at your neighbor and say, you don't know me like that. Amen. They said, we know who this man is. He's the carpenter's son, and here are his brothers and his sisters. Here's their reasoning. We know him, and we are not much. We can't do much. We haven't achieved much, and therefore, he can't do much either. They weighed him by their own estimate and evaluation of themselves. They were looking at the outside. They had every reason to believe. They had heard about the mighty works that he had been doing. But when they looked at him, they didn't see a mighty man on the outside. So they missed the mighty Christ on the inside and let appearances abbreviate their faith. I need you, if you believe, to look at your neighbor and say, I'm more than I look like. Amen. Come on, talk to them. Say, my wig may not be on straight. My braids may not be in a straight row. My mustache may not be cut like it need to be cut. My hair may be too long for your taste. My clothes might be off a little bit, but I'm more than I look like. Don't ever judge me by what I look like, because you don't know what I came through in order just to get this far. They missed the mighty Christ on the inside. And you may be in a situation today that looks impossible. You may be looking at circumstances that seem insurmountable. You may be saying to yourself, my situation is hopeless. There's just no way out. But before you surrender, before you quit, before you walk away, can I suggest you talk to Moses and ask him about the Red Sea? Can I suggest you talk to Joshua and ask him about Jericho? miracle? Can I suggest you talk to David and ask him about Goliath? Can I suggest you talk to Daniel about that lion's den? Can I suggest you talk to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego about that fiery furnace? Because if a sea couldn't stop Moses, and if a wall couldn't stop Joshua, and if a giant couldn't stop David, and if death couldn't stop Jesus, then know that by the grace of God, there is nothing that can stop you. Don't permit your faith to be abbreviated by appearances. And I hear you. You're saying, but Pastor, look, I don't have a degree. I don't have a network. I don't have support. I don't have the cash, and nor do I have the credit. But I say to you, my friend, all of your excuses are based on external appearances, how things look to you right now. You've got to be able to look beyond what you see and envision what you believe. I see sickness, but I'm believing for health. I see poverty, but I'm believing for prosperity. I see loneliness, but I still believe in love. I see struggle, but I'm believing for success. Don't permit yourself to be infected by the Nazareth syndrome. The Nazareth syndrome declares seeing is believing, but God declares believing is seeing, because anything you see, everything you see has temporary stamped on it. 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, for the things that are seen are temporary, but the things that are not seen, they are eternal. What do you need God to do in your life today? Whatever it is, I want to tell you, God can do it. Where's Kirk Carr when you need him? He wrote a song that said, I've seen him do it. Because nothing is impossible with God. So take the shackles off your faith. Lift the limits off your faith. And refuse to be ruled by appearances or impossibilities. Dismiss your negative thoughts and dispel your negative doubts. And let God go to work in your life. Because thirdly, we limit the power of God working in us and for us when we permit our faith, listen to me, to be rooted in reason alone. Logic has limits. Did you hear what I just said? It can help you understand many things. I was a philosophy major in undergrad, and logic has limits. There are things that logic cannot resolve. Can I give you one? Can God create a rock too heavy for God to lift? If you explore that, you immediately come to the limits of logic, because no matter how you answer it, you come up with the wrong answer. Preach, brother. Amen. Logic can help you to determine some things with a degree of relative certainty, but when the subject is the incomprehensible God, logic is always limited, because faith reaches beyond reason and past logic. God moves in a mysterious way, his wonders to perform. He plants his feet upon the sea and rides upon the storm. And periodically, God will ask you and lead you and direct you to do things that to some may appear unreasonable, things that don't make sense to anybody, things like forgive your enemies, things like praise while you're still in pain, things like give even when you have a need, things like step where you can't see and trust where you can't trace. The people at Nazareth reasoned this thing out. They figured he had come from Nazareth and nothing good could possibly come out of Nazareth. Nazareth was considered a bad joke, a place for the poor, the trifling, and the ignorant. Even the people that lived there had no confidence in themselves or their abilities. That's why Nathanael asked in John chapter 1, when the disciples told him, we have found the Christ, he said, can anything good come out of Nazareth? But it does not matter, my friends, whether you come from a big place or a little place. It's hard for people who knew you then to know you now. That was their struggle with Jesus. We know this dude. We remember him when. We know his people. We know his cousin them. We know where he started. We done talked to his mom and them. And whenever people think they know something about you, they will inevitably try to throw shade at you. I'm not one to talk, but you do know there was some question about who his daddy was. He ain't nobody. That was their challenge when Jesus wanted to feed the multitude. Immediately, Philip pulled out his pocket calculator to try to figure it out according to logic. That's why he said it would take a year's salary to feed all these people, because for him, it wasn't an issue of faith. It was an issue of finances. But hear me today, faith extends beyond finances, because in that same experience, Jesus took two fish and five loaves from a little lad's lunch and fed everybody until they were full and had leftovers. It's not so much where you come from as it is what comes from you. Take me to a town called Bonn and I'll give you Beethoven. Take me to a town called Milan and I'll give you Thomas Edison. Take me to Ulm and I'll give you Edison. Take me to Akron and I'll give you LeBron James. Take me to Richmond and I'll give you Patrick Henry, John Marshall, Bill Bojangles Robinson, Doug Wilder, and D'Angelo. Take me to a ghetto on the east side of Detroit and I'll give you Francis Ford Coppola, Stevie Wonder, Diana Ross, Smokey Robinson, Eminem, Ed McMahon, Madonna, Henry Ford, Aretha Franklin, and a little cat named Lance Watson. It's not so much where you're from as it is what comes from you, because sometimes reason will restrain your reach and tie up your possibilities, because reason can only take you part of the way. It's like trying to go from here to Paris by car. You can get on I-95, head north or south, but sooner or later, you're going to discover that there's no highway over the Atlantic, so you're going to have to give up one vehicle and find you a submarine, a boat, or a plane. Don't miss this. The car took you as far as it could take you, but you'll have to find another vehicle to take you all the way. And that's what faith is like. Reason and logic will take you part of the way. But if you want to make it to your desired destination, you're going to have faith. And somebody listening to me is already a witness, because it happened to you with an illness. The doctors, the nurses, the therapists, the practitioners took you as far as they could take you. The medicine helped, the treatment helped, but then you got to a point where they had taken you as far as they could, and the only way you survived, the only way you are here today, is that you had a consultation and an appointment with Dr. Jesus, and he worked it out. Every great dream, every noble accomplishment requires somebody to go beyond what others consider reasonable. If you don't attempt great things, you will never achieve great things. And today is the day to lift your limits. You can't go back and change the beginning, but you can start where you are and change the end. Now is the time for you to make your move. Why, preacher? Because God is your Father, and Christ is your Savior, and the Spirit is your power, and the church is your family, and heaven is your home, and joy is your strength, and faith is your victory. Bump somebody and say, move right now. See, make up your mind. You're going to be like the Energizer Bunny. And you've seen the commercial. It's about a bunny rabbit that keeps going and beating his drum no matter what happens. Every time somebody tries to stop him, they can't, because their power runs out before his. He just keeps going and going and going and going and going. Touch somebody, say, keep going. See, and that's why people are confused right now looking at you, because they've been trying to stop you and you just keep going and going and going and going. Somebody is a witness that God's power kept you going. You should have been dead, but you're still going. You should have quit by now, but you're still going. The divorce should have did you in, but you're still going. The sickness should have taken you out, but you're still going. The heartache, the cancer, the breakup, the letdown, the layoff, the disappointment, the backstabbing should have torn your life apart, but you're still going, and you keep going and going and going and going and going. And going. The enemy couldn't stop Jesus, so don't let him stop you. Peter denied him, but he was still going. Judas betrayed him, but he was still going. Thomas doubted him, but he was still going. His family misunderstood him, but he was still going. His friends forsook him, but he was still going. The soldiers beat him, but he was still going. The crowd mocked him, but he was still going. Nailed to a tree, but he was still going. Sealed in his grave, but still going. Guarded in his death, but Sunday morning. I said Sunday morning. I said Sunday morning. God raised him up with all power in his hands. He was still going, and God gave him a name that was above every name, still going, that at the name of Jesus, every knee must bow and every tongue must confess. He was still going, and I'm glad. I said I'm glad that he's still going right now. Still making ways, still opening doors, still paying bills, still working miracles, still fighting battles, still saving people, still keeping people, still drying tears, still calming fears, still extending years, still healing. Is there anybody here who can testify that God kept you going? Will break out of your reservation. Shake hands with your neighbor. Shake your head at them and say, nobody but God. God is working in my life. God is giving me peace. God is giving me joy. God is giving me satisfaction. God is giving me contentment. God is giving me victory. So for everything that God has done in my life, for making ways, for opening doors, every time I turn around, I've got to give him a praise. I know it's homecoming, but on a day like this, in a place like this, having come from where I came from, having come through what I came through, having dealt with what I've dealt with, I've still got to give him praise. Look at your neighbor and say, this ain't about you. This is about me and God. And if you knew what God has brought me through, you'd be hollering for me. You'd be waving for me. You'd be shouting for me. Because it is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he'll do for you. If it was a secret, then I would know that he'll fight your battle. If it was a secret, then I would know he'll heal your body. If it was a secret, then I would know he'll pay your child's tuition. If it was a secret, then I would know he'll make your enemies leave you alone. But it is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, won't he do it? I said, won't he do it? Don't fool me now. Have you tried him? Ain't he all right? Throw your head back and just say, he's all right with me. Testify to your neighbor and say, I tried him. I found out he's all right. Just all right. Just all right. Just all right with me. Lift the limits. Stand with me all over the building. Take your neighbor by the hand. Talk to him for a moment. Say, neighbor, I've got a good word for you today. On this homecoming Sunday, what you see as your ceiling, God sees as your floor. Let that marinate for a moment. What you think is your best, God sees as your everyday. What you call a miracle, God just calls an ordinary blessing. But you got to lift the limits of your faith. heads are bowed and eyes are closed. God, on this homecoming Sunday, we lift your name up. We give you the honor. We give you the glory. We give you the praise for just another day you blessed us to see. Thank you for your word that speaks to us at the point of our need and changes us from the inside out. So we pray for every brother, every sister under the sound of my voice that you would meet us now at the point of our need and love us to life. Love us to the next level. Love us until we trust and obey. And we give you all the glory in Jesus' name. And the whole church shouted, amen. Amen. The doors of this church are open. The invitation is extended. The choir is going to sing. Deacons and ministers will be on the aisle. I want to invite you to come out of the balcony, off the wings, off the main floor. There's no better day to come home than on homecoming. So we invite you to become a part of the family of faith. If you're here, come now. Let go and let God. Y'all got a song? Come on. Don't make me start singing.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Help me celebrate this family.
I am
welcome
free.
In the name of the Lord. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Praise the Lord.
Are there others?
Free.
I see you, my sister. Welcome. Come on, give God a chance. No more chains.
No more chains holding me.
My soul, welcome,
my
welcome.
Soul is resting.
I see you. Welcome in the name of the Lord.
It's just a blessing.
It's just a blessing. Welcome, welcome. Somebody ought to celebrate. Somebody ought to celebrate.
Hallelujah.
Welcome.
I'm free.
Welcome. Praise the Lord.
I'm free.
I am. Praise the Lord. Come on.
Praise the Lord.
Come on.
No longer.
Make this homecoming your homecoming. Come. No more chains.
No more chains holding me.
My soul is resting.
My soul is resting.
It's such a blessing.
It's just a blessing.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm free.
Help me celebrate all these brothers and sisters who have come today. We welcome you all in the name of the Lord. We're excited to have you in Jesus' name. Come on, if I can shake their hands, you can applaud them. Welcome. Hey, baby. Hey, baby. Let's pray for them. Stretch your hands in their direction. Lord, how we thank you and we praise you for those who have responded to your word. And we pray for them as we pray over them, your blessing, your love, your peace, your power, that whatever they need, we know you can provide. So Jehovah Jireh, be their provider. Jehovah Rapha, be their healer. Jehovah Shammah, be with them, oh God. Jehovah Nissi, fight their battles and give them the victory. And we will give you all the glory in Jesus' name. And all the people shouted hallelujah. Shout amen. Give them a great big hand as they go with our commitment counselors, if you would go that way. Come on, celebrate them, celebrate them, celebrate them. Heaven is happy. Oh, that's a great song. Down in my soul. Y'all know that song?
Down in my soul.
Sweet, beautiful.
Sweet, beautiful.
Soul saving.
Soul saving joy.
Oh, joy.
Oh, joy. Joy in my soul.
Sing it again. Joy, joy, everybody.
Sweet, beautiful joy, soul-saving joy.
out telling them what kind of joy. Lily of the valley joy. Alpha and Omega.
Alpha and Omega joy.
Joy, 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 joy.
Food on my table joy.
Food on my table joy.
I know that he is able joy.
I know that he is able joy.
And when I can't say nothing, I just say, joy. I tell the choir, y'all better come on, because every Sunday I have a praise in my pocket. And I love y'all, I need y'all, but I got a praise in my pocket. Praise the Lord. We're going to worship God through the giving of our tithe, our offering, our gifts of love. As the scoop pointed out at the beginning of the service, we're in a small campaign to try to pay off our mortgage by the third Sunday in November, our 115th church anniversary. The campaign is called The Big Give, where we're encouraging our members to give a day's pay to help us put the mortgage away. 818 people already have. We invite you to join them. That 818 have given almost $250,000. Amen. So please join them as you give today. Today, after service, we are giving away hundreds of pairs of sneakers for children as they prepare to return to school this fall. And we're excited about the opportunity to gift into their life, but it's May. Possible through the faithful and generous giving of members of this congregation and friends of this community. So we encourage you today to give as God has blessed you on this homecoming day. I want to make you a promise. Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor,
neighbor.
This promise
is from Pastor Watson.
Look him right now. This is personal. Say, neighbor.
He said,
to tell you he owe you a chicken dinner. Because typically on homecoming we serve a chicken dinner, and today we're only doing cupcakes because we're trying to put all our money together to pay off the mortgage. But I owe you a chicken dinner, and I always keep my promises, so you hang around. Now, I didn't say when it was coming. But as long as I owe you one, you'll have one coming. Amen. But we're going to worship God through our giving today. The choir is going to sing. We're going to extend, as they sing, the right hand of fellowship to our new members today. All of you stand, all of our new members. Give them some love today. Yeah. We're going to pray over our offering, extend to them the right hand of fellowship. We're going to give as the choir sings. Let's pray. Lord, we pray over all of these new members and thank you for their presence today. We thank you for this, the day of their baptism. We pray your blessing to rest upon their lives and bless us as we worship you by giving our tithe and giving our offering. Bless the gift and the giver in Jesus' name. And everybody shouted, amen.
Amen.
Come on, choir, and sing for us. Come on, new members, and line up for us. And we're going to welcome you into the fellowship with the right hand of fellowship. Today is SMB Sunday. All SMB, stand up, stand up. These are all of our... Come on, give them some love. We celebrate them.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, can you give God a great praise one more time for all of our new members? As we welcome our new members, we want to continue on our life stage journey, starting now with the years of the 1990s, going into the 2000s, the 2010s, and even the current age. Amen. Come on, clap your hands all over the room. Let's go. Thank you.
Let the church say amen. Last year, your generosity made it possible for us to purchase uniforms for the marching band of the Highland Springs High School, and they are here today to take us out by way of benediction. So stand to your feet all over the building and help me welcome the marching band of the Highland Springs High School. Come on, show them some love. Show them some love. Show them some love. I think they're there. There you go. Come on, welcome them. Welcome them. Not into a silent room. Welcome them.
Thank you. morning. Just wanted to make a quick announcement. This, I'm Mrs. Yonkers, Mr. Yonkers, and our band staff, Ms. Brown, and Coach Will, somewhere the way he went. So we want to make an announcement. Due to generous donations from this church family, we were able to begin the process of getting our new uniforms. So we just wanted to show you just an example of what the new uniforms will look like. So again, thank you so much for your donation, and always welcome them back to do your homecoming. Thank you.
Come on, let's give them a great big applause. They're going to take us out of here. As you leave today, get a cupcake on your way out.